was the pastor here at Brighton. And I remember that every Sabbath morning we used to meet just back there for a little prayer meeting. One of the things we prayed for was that the Lord would eventually bring us more members. The amazing thing, when I stepped in here this morning, I think I have seen more faces that I didn't know than faces that I did know. And I thank the Lord for that. And I pray that God will continue to bless this church and to let it fulfill its purpose here in this community. And I'm sure that little ones growing up like little Valerie and others will help to contribute towards that. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer as we ask him to be with us as we study. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the privilege of being able to open your word once more. Lord, we have sung hymns to you. We have seen a dedication. We have prayed. We have given offerings to you. And Father, we thank you for all of these privileges. But Lord, now we want to hear a word from you, from your word. And we just ask that your Spirit will be here to guide us as we think. Help us to understand what we read, and may it make a difference to how we live. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like you to turn with me in your Bibles to a passage of Scripture that was written by the Apostle Peter under inspiration there in the back of the New Testament. 1 Peter chapter 2. It's after the book of Hebrews that we've been studying in our senior lesson. Little book of 1 Peter, and we want chapter 2 and verses 9, 10 and 12. I'm reading from the New International Version. It says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." And then down to verse 12, "Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." It's a very powerful passage of Scripture. In fact, as you read these words, they seem like an ideal passage to reflect on at the beginning of a new year. They're really a declaration of Christian identity, and they encompass a response, an answer, to one of the great questions of life. You know, we call those great questions of life often, where did I come from? Why am I here? Where am I going? This particular passage answers the question, number two, why am I here? How should I live my life as a Christian in this present world? If you go back to the early part of the chapter, it actually provides some context for why Peter writes as he does here. Let's just go back to verse 2. He says, "Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good." And as he follows on, he actually expresses some very clear dreams that he has for his people as they come, particularly to a new year, if you like. It's as if God does actually have a dream for us. He has a plan, a desire that he longs to see fulfilled in us this year. There in verse 2, we've just read that we may grow up in our salvation. Dear friends, what does that mean? What does God actually want here? He wants me to mature spiritually this year. That's fair enough, isn't it? Yes, he wants us to mature spiritually. If you come down to verse 5, it says, "You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood." Here's another part of what God longs to see, what he dreams for his people to be like, that we might continue being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. Why does he want that for us? Dear friends, he wants us as a church to be able to minister ever more effectively to our community. Because isn't that what priests do? They minister. Come down to verse 9. Notice you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. What does he want here? He would love to have us testify or share about what he has done for us. Dear friends, isn't that a good dream for us to do as we go into 2022? What else can we tell about God other than what he has actually done for us? And here, God actually says, that's what I want you to do. I want you to testify. Because, dear friends, testimonies end up being very powerful. That is often the way that people start to get drawn to the things of God. But then notice verse 10 and 11. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. What's he actually wanting us to do here? What's he actually dreaming for us? He would love us to appreciate and cherish the mercy that we have received. Dear friends, often we look back at what Jesus has done for us and say, yeah, we've heard that so many times. And it's, of course I accept that, but I need to get on with living. Dear friends, what the Lord longs for is that we learn to cherish this mercy that he has poured out upon us. As we reflect on it more and more, it will actually change our lives. Not only that, but in verse 11, he goes on and he says, abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. In other words, he's longing that we would not actually end up being caught up in the many temptations and deceptions and things that Satan constantly tries to throw in our pathway. And dear friends, that's exactly what Jesus asked us to pray. Lead us not into temptation. It was an important part of the Lord's Prayer for us too. So am I surprised that the Apostle Peter writes it again under inspiration? No, not at all. And then have a look at verse 12. To live such good lives among the people of this world that they may see our good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Dear friends, in many ways, it sounds like a good summary for a comprehensive New Year's resolution from God for us in 2022. His vision of a good year. Remember, at the beginning of a new year, we often say, oh, have a happy new year. The trouble is, it's so glib as it runs off the tongue that we often sort of think, well, what do we really mean when we say, have a happy new year? Dear friends, I'm going to suggest to you that God has actually outlined here, if these things happened in our lives in 2022, we would have a good and a happy year in 2022. You know, I'm almost tempted to finish my sermon right there, to say the benediction and let you all go home early. And some of you would say, yeah, that was very good. Others of you would say, boy, he let us off short. Dear friends, there is something in what the Apostle Peter has written here that I want us to have a look at a little bit more closely before we finish. And that is that right here in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, as God seeks to articulate his dream for us, his earnest desire for our lives, he begins with a somewhat unexpected phrase. He says, "You are a chosen people." And it's fascinating that that is a thought that the apostle has mentioned before in this little book, this little letter that he writes. I want you to come back to chapter 1 and verse 2. Notice how he mentions it even there. As he's expressing to whom he is writing this letter, he says, "To God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered through Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling by his blood." It's fascinating. He uses that word chosen again. If you come down to chapter 2 and verse 4, notice it's mentioned there as well. "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood," and so on. But again, he uses that word chosen. Why does he declare that God chooses people? If he created us, it almost seems redundant to also say that he chooses us. Why is it so important that God wants us to know first that we are a chosen people? Dear friends, I also want you to notice that the Apostle Peter here is writing this under the guidance of the Holy Spirit to New Testament believers, including Gentiles. He's not writing to the Old Testament Israel. We are somewhat accustomed to thinking of the Old Testament Israel as the Jews and as God's chosen people. But why does God still persist with this idea of the chosen to refer to his people even in the New Testament? To many people today, choosing people sounds a little exclusive and narrowing, as if God has favorites. And there have, of course, been well-meaning believers down through history who have fostered that particular notion. And they've even taught that some have been chosen or predestined to be saved, while others have been chosen or predestined to be lost. You and I look with horror to people thinking that, especially the last bit. If God chooses people to be saved, does he also choose people to be lost? And yet, during the Protestant Reformation, two very important streams of Protestantism, Calvinism and Lutheranism, actually taught that very doctrine. And it still finds itself in some denominations today. But dear friends, let me say that just because the idea of the chosen has been misused or misapplied at some point doesn't mean that God made a mistake in his choice of words here. Dear friends, I believe it's actually an enlightening study to try and understand why God thinks of his children as a chosen people. We need to grasp its significance because, especially in a sin-infested world, it helps us to understand our identity and to also live our lives meaningfully for God. So, what does God actually mean by the word chosen? I don't know how many of you have ever thought about what it was like the night that you were conceived. Don't worry, I hadn't thought about it much either, until I read the stunning description that biologists assure us is true for all of us. Let me share. Your parents came together, whether they stayed together or ever really got together or were strangers, doesn't change this incredible scenario for any of us. Father deposited half a billion tiny male reproductive cells or sperm inside the mother, that's right, 500 million sperm, each with a solitary mission to find the single ovum, mother's egg, and to penetrate it. And only one of those sperm could make you, you. Which meant that it had to outswim the 499,999,999 other sperm in that race for life. And in the words of Anthony De Stefano, and I quote now, he says, half a billion potential human beings, each one completely different from you, could have been born in place of you had not that one unique sperm cell fertilized that one unique ovum. In a very real sense, half a billion other potential human beings had to forego life to make way for you. And then comes his stunning conclusion. From a strictly statistical point of view, your presence on this planet is a miracle. At the very dawn of your life, you had to overcome overwhelming odds, odds higher than any of you will ever have to face in any other situation. No matter what you may think of yourself now, no matter what ills may befall you in life, no matter what suffering you may be forced to endure, no matter what family or money problems you may eventually have to face, it is imperative that you understand this. You came into this world as a champion. Close quote. Dear friends, I don't know how that makes you feel this morning. But just in case you're thinking, well, that's a cute story. It's a nice way of looking at it. But really, it was a lottery. I'm actually a random quirk of nature. I want to take you to some very pertinent passages of Scripture. I want you to come with me, first of all, Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5. Back into the Old Testament. Jeremiah chapter 1. Here, as the prophet Jeremiah begins his book, notice what he writes in verse 5. Let's start in verse 4. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Dear friends, we haven't got the time to actually go and have a look at what this means in the context of Jeremiah's life. But the one thing that I do want you to notice is that God says of this young man who became a prophet for him, that before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. In other words, God understood. He already had a plan for this person who came to be known as Jeremiah. Before you were born, the second line in verse 5 says, I set you apart. Dear friends, that highlights the issue of God's choice very, very clearly. And in case you're thinking, well, that's an Old Testament reference, come with me to Galatians chapter 1 and verse 16. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 16. I'm going to share the New Living Translation of this one because I believe that it makes the point very well. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 16. Here, the Apostle Paul writing now, New Testament character. In other words, 1,000 years probably later, not quite, but many centuries. He says, but even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace. I want you to notice again how the Bible emphasizes this idea. Before I was born, I was chosen. Have a look at Ephesians, just the next book, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. And again, let me read from the New Living Translation. Here, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ. So the Apostle Paul is very convinced that this really is the case. But in case those are not enough for you, I want you to come back with me to the book of Psalms, back to an Old Testament passage. Psalm 139. Dear friends, in many ways, this blows me away. Psalm 139. And it's perhaps a good thing that we, as part of our worship service today, have had a child dedication, because all of this applies to little Valerie as it does to each one of us as well. Notice what the psalmist, and it's David, who is writing here. He wrote the majority of the psalms. He didn't write all of them. But have a look in verse 13 and on. He says, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. In other words, he wasn't just a quirk of nature. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Dear friends, that is actually the basis for why Christians have concerns about abortion. That is the biblical reason. We're not going to get into that particular debate this morning. But that's where we get our idea from, that life is sacred. God is the one who has actually knit us together. And even right at the beginning, not just in the 25th week or whatever. Notice it is said not only once, but multiple times in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Bible is clear that human beings are not random quirks of nature. We are chosen beings. So when on occasion we say with self-pitying tears about how meaningless and pointless my life really is, it's good for us to catch ourselves and stop and pause and think. But, someone may protest, you don't know my real situation. My parents didn't plan me. In fact, they didn't want me. I'm one big oops. And you may be right. But our text is compellingly clear this morning. There is someone in the universe who did want you and plan for you. Just like the unplanned, unwanted twins in the Old Testament book of Genesis chapter 38, Perez and Zerah, who ended up being in the Messiah's family tree. Because no matter your parents, you're still God's chosen. And some of you may sort of be trying to think ahead a little bit here and saying, well, does that mean that God ordains every circumstance under which a child is conceived on our planet? No, dear friends, I don't believe that that is the case. But does God choose to accept and honor and plan for every particular human being born into our race? Absolutely. But I was born with a terrible disability, you might point out, which makes me a mistake of nature. Dear friends, over the last couple of days here in Australia, we've actually had a man with disability being named as the Australian of the Year. And how many of us are actually glad that he is an Australian, that he's part of our society? Look at the things that he is able to say. Dear friends, I've been moved by the interviews that he has given. Very self-effacing interviews, very humble interviews, but he clearly discerns that he is here for a reason. And dear friends, I have to think of others who were born with disability. What about Helen Keller? Blind, deaf, and dumb. It's fascinating to me that she wrote, I seldom think about my limitations and they never make me sad. Perhaps there is just a touch of yearning at times, but it is vague like the breeze among the flowers. I can not do everything, she wrote, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something that I can do. What a wonderful attitude. And dear friends, it has made her a person whom we look up to and say, yes, she has grasped the significance of her life despite her disabilities. In fact, she went on to write this. She said, all the world is full of suffering. It's also full of overcoming. Self-pity is our worst enemy, she wrote. And if we yield to it, we can never do anything wise in this world. We could never learn to be brave and patient if there were only joy in the world. Think about it. I can see, she finished off, And that is why I can be happy in what you call the dark. Because, of course, she's blind. How can she say, I can see? She goes on and says, what I see is actually golden. It's not dark. I can see a God-made world, not a man-made world. Dear friends, when a person like Helen Keller can write things like that, and I'm sure that we could give many other examples of where people who have actually had problems and disabilities and so on and so forth have still fulfilled very important roles in our world. But you may respond, the reality is that I'm actually too old now to be chosen for anything anyway. Are you serious? Tell that to Anna, the widowed elderly prophetess, whose entire life was a countdown to 5 minutes of recognizing the infant Messiah in his mother's arms and proclaiming him to everyone in the temple who would listen. Tell that to Moses, whose entire first 80 years of life were but a prelude to a surprise extra 40 years of unexpected leadership. Because no matter your age, you're still God's chosen one. Dear friends, if you're God's chosen, then that can only mean that he has a destiny for you. A very unique mission for a very unique creation. Dear friends, when you start to think of it that way, you begin to realize that when God calls us his chosen, it actually has a world of meaning. He wants us to grasp an important fact about our identity. What more can we ask if we are chosen, if we are accepted? But the interesting thing is, in one of those passages that I got you to look up, if you go back to Ephesians chapter 1 and verses 4 and 5, God seems to escalate or even heighten what he's trying to say. Again, let me read from the New Living Translation. Long ago, even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. His unchanging plan has always been to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. And this gave him great pleasure. Dear friends, it's a beautiful picture. In other words, this choosing was actually part of a long-range plan, not an on-the-spot decision, and it gave him great pleasure. But notice how he amplifies this choosing with the metaphor of adoption. When you adopt a child, there is actually no oops. There's no accident, as there might be with an unwanted pregnancy. When you adopt a child, you choose the child very carefully and intentionally. The clear implication is that God also chose carefully and intentionally when he chose us to be his children. It was not an accident. In fact, our adoption papers were registered and signed in the blood at Calvary. He made no mistake. He made us accepted in the Beloved. Dear friends, what else could we ask for? Chosen children of the Heavenly King. Our connection to him is very strong and intimate. As 1 Peter 2 verse 9 puts it, we are a chosen people and a people belonging to God. But then the question still comes. How does this choosing actually work? Does he actually choose some and reject others? And the people he chooses have no say in the matter? What about a passage like Malachi chapter 1? I'm sure you've come across this. And if you've got biblically literate friends, they might have even thrown this one at you. And they said, well, what do you make of that? Is that your God of love? Have a look at it. Last book in the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 1. Notice verses 2 to 5. I have loved you, says the Lord, but you ask, how have you loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother? The Lord says, yet I have loved Jacob, but Esau I have hated, and I have turned his mountains into a wasteland and left his inheritance to the desert jackals. Edom may say, though we have been crushed, we will rebuild the ruins. But this is what the Lord Almighty says, they may build, but I will demolish. They will be called the wicked land, a people always under the wrath of the Lord. Dear friends, I don't know whether you've ever read that passage and wondered, well, how does that work? We could go to other passages in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 2. The trouble is, what the casual reader doesn't like here is the perceived arbitrary unfairness. The trouble is that that particular perception could be extended through many other scriptural passages, it seems. In fact, as you go through the Bible, it seems to be a regular theme. For example, in the antediluvian world before the flood, the Bible says it includes the story about a man named Noah and his family. These eight get chosen, and the rest of the world seems to be rejected. A little bit later, a pagan family in chapter 12 in Ur of the Chaldees has a boy named Abram. He gets chosen by God and the rest of the family left out. Abraham has two sons. It seems that both are chosen by God, but only one gets the highest destiny. Isaac has two sons. One gets chosen by God, the other gets left on the sidelines of a lesser destiny, as we've just read in Malachi. The chosen son, Jacob, has 12 sons. The second youngest one gets chosen by God to be the deliverer, and the others end up bowing down to him. The land of Egypt is filled with the children of Israel, and after some time, God chooses the slaves and rejects the taskmasters. Israel cross over into the promised land and clamor for a king. God chooses Saul, but then seems to unchoose him for a young shepherd named David. The kingdom of Israel prospers and grows and then apostatizes and falls. King succeeds king, some chosen by God, others rejected, until finally all that's left is a remnant. It seems to the undiscerning reader as if there is an ongoing, continuous, arbitrary selection process. So how do we understand it? Perhaps an illustration from the days of the schoolyard playground can help. Back in my days at school, at recess time, the teacher would often ask the two biggest boys in the class to choose up teams for some sport in which winning mattered. Some of you can probably remember how the rest of us would line up or mill around waiting for our names to be called. You would stand there nervously holding your breath, shifting your weight from one foot to the other, hoping against hope that this time you'd be chosen. But as the captains picked their way through the group, the line was getting shorter and shorter, and every name called out left you with the dreadful thought, I may not get chosen at all. And some of us painfully know that it's no fun not to be chosen. Nobody likes to be left out in any race in life. But when and if your name is called, at last, you usually race over to join your team and the captain who chose you and delivered you from that lonely line. And you gladly choose to be on that side. Because that captain chose you first, you choose him back. Dear friends, that is actually the key to understanding God's choices. They are not arbitrary, one-sided decisions. They have a reciprocal nature. God chooses us, but we have the opportunity to choose him back or reject him for that matter. That's why Jesus actually says in John chapter 15 and verses 15 and 16, it's a very fascinating chapter. You remember John 15 is where he starts talking about the vine and the branches. And remember, it's all part of what Jesus tells his disciples on the night before he's crucified. But in John chapter 15 and verse 15 and 16, he says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." Dear friends, Jesus is like the captain, and he initiates the choices. We do not actually initiate the choices. But he also says this in Matthew chapter 22 and verse 14. "For many are called, but what? But few are chosen." And dear friends, how does that fit into the situation? Actually, God doesn't play favorites at all. Sadly, God's choices are often stopped in their tracks or stymied, not because God changes his mind, but because we as human beings don't choose him back. He calls, but we don't respond. So it looks, in fact, as if few are chosen. But it's not actually the way that it looks from God's point of view. Dear friends, that's why God continues to raise men and women who earnestly call people repeatedly to choose him back. Choose whom you will serve. Dear friends, if we had the time, I would take you to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 and 20. A very powerful call. We talked about it in our Sabbath school lessons last quarter. Joshua chapter 24, verse 15. Revelation 22, verse 17. And we could go to many other places where the call is, "Come, come, I am choosing you. Please choose whom you will serve." Dear friends, God always initiates the choosing process, lovingly creating the new combinations of life that we all represent, and then calling all of his children to himself, because actually he loves us all, not just some. That's what John 3:16 says, doesn't it? "For God so loved the Seventh-day Adventist Church." No. "For God so loved the world." But we are the ones, in the way that he has set it up, we are the ones who choose to close the deal or not. Dear friends, if God is willing to choose us to be adopted into his family with all the provisions made, why wouldn't we want to choose him back? And dear friends, I pray that this year of 2022, we will choose him back every morning. We will say, "Lord, thank you for a new day of life. I want to live my life for you today. Take control, please. Take my life, let it be consecrated to you. Take each moment, take each hour, take the day. Make me your representative. But this leads us to our final consideration. What's the purpose that God has in choosing us? As muted earlier, dear friends, if we are chosen by God, handcrafted by the Creator, then that can only mean He has a destiny for each of us, a very unique mission for a very unique creation. It is God's dream for us that we fulfill that destiny. And dear friends, that is why Bible writers write things like this. Quickly come to these passages in Psalm 31. Psalm 31. Again, I think it is David who is actually writing. Yes, it is. Psalm 31 and verses 3 to 5. He says, "Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead me and guide me. Free me from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Redeem me, O Lord, the God of truth." Dear friends, just come back a few pages to Psalm 25. While I was over in the United States doing my doctoral work, I remember while I was doing my dissertation, I was reading through the Psalms, and this psalm became a very special prayer for me. In fact, I have used it many times since. But I want you to see what the burden of this particular prayer is, and it is actually a personal prayer. And again, it is David who wrote it. Notice particularly down here in verse 4, he says, "Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour, and my hope is in you all day long." In other words, I will actually end up being happy if I fulfill the destiny that you have for me. But show me what that destiny is. And it's fascinating, he goes on to say in verse 6, "Remember, O Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth." What's he saying? He's saying, I don't deserve to have a destiny that you have marked out. I've disappointed you so many times. But please, may your mercy extend, and may you still show me your path. Teach me your ways. Guide me in your truth. In fact, if you come down here, notice in verse 8, it says, "Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways." It doesn't say he instructs the righteous. Dear friends, it's very important sometimes as you meditate about these passages and say, what else could it have said? Here it says, "Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in his ways." Yes, God is actually willing to teach us about the destiny that he has for us, to teach us his way. Dear friends, isn't that amazing? Isn't it amazing that he is willing, despite our frailty, to say, "I will teach you"? Notice he then goes on and writes, "He guides the humble in what is right." Dear friends, if you're arrogant, you say, "Well, I know what I want to do anyway." Well, then it makes it very difficult for God to say, "Can you come here, please?" Then notice in verse 10, it says, "All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful for those who keep the demands of his covenant." It's fascinating, dear friends, when it says all the ways, it means even the things that look like reverses. Things that look like suffering and trouble. It says all the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful. Dear friends, if we really believe that, can you imagine the peace that we would actually have in our hearts? Other people would look and say, how come How come you are so calm about all the stuff? Dear friends, in verse 12, in my Bible, I've actually written two dates. Claimed on March 14, 1992. It was a difficult time, a difficult year in my life. But look at what it says. Who then is the man that fears the Lord? He will instruct him in the way chosen for him. Doesn't say he might. It says he will. Dear friends, that should give us confidence. It should give us trust that whatever happens, as I put my life into his care, he will actually lead me and guide me to fulfill the destiny he has for me. And dear friends, in his promise, his plan for us, there's always a personal benefit and a blessing. There's even a benefit for our fellow human beings. And there's also glory to God in the choices that God has made. And that's why we do end up having a happy new year if we take this on board. Dear friends, it's a big dream that God has for us and our world, despite our fallenness. It's a broad vision, a comprehensive mission that he would like us all to be part of. He's designed it to bring happiness, fulfillment, joy, purpose, and meaning to all. But sometimes it's actually beyond our understanding in the way that it works out. And let me, in closing, finish with this story. It says, in the mid-1950s, Jim and Elizabeth Elliot were a young missionary couple in Ecuador. Passionate about sharing the gospel. Initially, they lived with the Quechua Indians, but Jim felt called to reach out and share Christ with the Aucas, who lived deep in the jungle and were known for being savage. Jim pulled together a team of four other men, and together they flew a small plane over the jungle in search of the Auca villages. One day, after much searching, they actually spotted it on the banks of the Kurai River. Initially, they made low-flying trips over the village, dropping gifts. And then they found a small strip of sand a little further along the river, and the five missionaries began to plan to fly in, build a treehouse, and set up camp so that they could bring the gospel to the Aucas. Although their first encounter with an Auca man and two girls seemed positive, the next day the Aucas attacked, destroying the plane and the five missionaries. They were all murdered. This was an event that shocked the world, but was providentially set to change a people. After Jim Elliot's death, Elizabeth, his wife, decided to continue working among the Quechua for two more years. And during this time, she devoted herself to learning the Hua language, preparing herself to go to the Auca people that had killed her husband and to share the gospel with them. In October 1958, I was only a young boy at the time. Elizabeth Elliot, her three-year-old daughter, Valerie, and Rachel Saint, the sister of one of the other martyred missionaries, went to live with the tribe that had killed their husband, father, and brother. Elizabeth was with the Aucas for only 2 years, while Rachel stayed until she passed away on November 11, 1994. After moving to the village, Elizabeth began to teach the Auca Indians from the Bible. Her forgiveness and acceptance of the tribe are what led them to accept Jesus Christ. She taught them to forgive fearlessly, to love tremendously, which forever transformed their way of life. In fact, one of the first men to receive Jesus as his Lord and Savior was Minke, one of the men who had killed the missionaries with spears. Minke became a Christian leader among the Alka, the majority of whom are still Christ followers today. Why did Elizabeth Elliot go back to the people who had murdered her husband? What drove this intrepid lady for God? How did she find joy in the jungle? In her own words, she said, "Everything, if given to God, can become your gateway to joy. Joy not in self-assertion, but in self-abandonment for the sake of Christ and the gospel." In other words, fulfilling the mission that God has for us. God commands that we preach the gospel. I just knew God's love was for everyone, and so the question of my personal safety was wholly irrelevant. Dear friend, she was a strong lady. So, was it part of God's plan? Did God actually choose for Jim Elliot to die like that? Or, if you want to go back to Bible times, for John the Baptist to be decapitated? Was that God's plan? Dear friends, this is where the mystery still clouds our understanding to some extent. But we can be totally confident that God does have a purpose that can turn any circumstance in our world into a positive if we let it and if our attitudes are turned to His. All we need to decide is, do we trust Him? Elizabeth Elliot wrote this, "Faith is a decision. It's not a deduction from the facts around us. We would not look at the world of today and logically conclude that God loves us. It doesn't always look as though He does. Faith is not an instinct. It certainly is not a feeling. Feelings don't help much when you're in the lion's den or when you're hanging on a wooden cross. Faith is not inferred from the happy way things always work. It is an act of the will, a choice based on the unbreakable word of God, who cannot lie, and who showed us what love and obedience and sacrifice mean in the person of Jesus Christ." Dear friends, that's a powerful statement, especially from someone who lost her husband in the way that she did. She could have become an embittered lady for the rest of her life. But she doesn't choose that path. So, dear friends, we've come full circle. How shall we live in this new year of 2022? Why does God start out with His exhortation in 1 Peter 2:9 with that unexpected phrase? Dear friends, first of all, He wants us to be totally convinced and confident that God has indeed chosen us. There is purpose and meaning in my life, despite the many negative personal circumstances and setbacks that I might face in this world. Number two, every day make it your first work to choose God back. Keep trusting and choosing to experience His direction and guidance. Consecrate yourself to Him every morning. And lastly, dear friends, participate or engage in the destiny and the mission that God has for your unique life. As He impresses you with your Bible reading, as He opens the way, as He opens doors, as He leads through conversations that you have with fellow believers, as He inspires us and as He gives us responsibilities, determined to do them to the best of your ability. Remember the promise. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. And dear friends, What more positive message can we leave this place with this morning? Dear friends, I wanted to finish our service with a very beautiful hymn written by a very smart young lady, Frances Ridley Havergal. I'm not sure what is the time. Are you willing? Let me share. It's a song that she wrote. In fact, she died herself in her early 40s, a tragedy. She was an amazing person, very spiritual lady, but she knew what it was to believe that she was chosen, to commit herself every day to God and get involved in the destiny that He had for her. And look at what she wrote. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands, let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Dear friends, I want to share with you a new tune, a more recent tune than the one we have in our hymn book. And I think it will perhaps help it stick in your mind. I'm going to go to the piano and I'm going to play through once, and the words will go up on the screen so that you can actually see. I'll play through play through it completely once, and then I'm going to ask you to join and sing, and we'll stand as we sing, okay? Let me just go to the piano and play it through so that you can get an idea of the melody. I'm sure you'll be able to pick it up easily. Little introduction like this.